Good morning, this is Angela with Parkrest Permaculture. It is a chilly, rainy day here in Portland, Oregon, in my Zone 8B permaculture garden. I got a request recently, multiple requests actually, asking how I use organic and sustainable methods to treat powdery mildew in my garden. And I had mentioned in a couple of videos that sometimes I spray with milk, and folks said, what is your process for that? So let me just go over today with what I use to do a foliar spray for my plants that are prone to powdery mildew. Now, let me give a little caveat here. In permaculture, we ideally want to create a system that is fully in balance, and so pest and disease pressures are not so great that they overwhelm a crop. They exist in balance in the system and are kept in check by other factors. However, my garden is in a place that was extremely depleted before I started gardening, and some elements of my design are probably out of balance as I am trying to cram a lot into a quarter acre. I also have some plants that are a little bit of a stretch for my zone and my climate, and therefore maybe wouldn't exist ideally in a permaculture system that had excellent planning, but I like the plants enough that I'm willing to give them the extra little bit of coddling that they need to do well. For most plants in my garden, I don't spray, I don't handhold them, I don't baby them. They need to be strong and resilient or they're out and I try something else. But there are a few things I'm kind of a sucker for. And also, again, a few things in my garden that through no fault of their own, the system is a little bit out of balance still, and they need some assistance from me. And one of the ways that I help my plants in this rainy, gray climate combat powdery mildew is that I use a spray on them. And that spray is homemade, and I'm gonna talk you through how I make it today and then show you how I apply it. So to make my spray, I use an old repurposed spray bottle. This was one that was my sister's. It had organic veggie wash in it, which I think you can just make yourself at home with soap nuts and water and baking soda. It's really easy. But anyway, this is not going to go in the recycle. The nozzle's still really good. Might as well reuse it. It's lasted me for a long time for this purpose. So you need a spray bottle, and you want to make sure that this is not something that you use commercial products in. I do use this also to do foliar sprays, spritzes of other things like humic acid and, comfrey tea and things like that. Things that are also beneficial to my plant. So I don't want to mix, I mean, I don't use any other fungicides or insecticides, but if you do in your garden, one, I hope you'll reconsider, but two, don't mix them with your sprays that are not going to be damaging to the environment. So what is powdery mildew and why do we want to deal with it? If you live somewhere where you have a rainy climate, you know the scourge that is powdery mildew. It is endemic in the environment. There's nothing you can do to eradicate it from your garden. The fungal spores live everywhere and they like warm, rainy weather. They like cool, rainy weather. They like overcast, humid days. And those fungal spores will proliferate on the leaves of your plants. They rarely impact fruit and sometimes impact flowers, but what you find is they tend to damage the leaf surface so much that the plant can no longer photosynthesize. It turns yellow, brown, shrivels. It's very common in things like akebia, roses, summer squash, and winter squash. There are a lot of other plants that can get powdery mildew, but those are the ones that tend to be the most heavily impacted in my climate. Everybody who watches my channel knows I love my roses. I have lots of them. Most of my roses are so healthy, they don't get powdery mildew, but I have one that struggles with it year after year after year. And whether it is because of the variety or because I planted it in a terrible spot with the worst soil right next to my shed, despite the fact that I feed it and I'm working on building the soil, it is probably the most ill-planted rose that I have, and so I don't blame it for struggling with this. I didn't set it up for success. It blooms huge and lush and covers my shed, but the leaves get powdery mildew every daggone year. So let's talk about what you want to add to make up this mixture that will help kill and suppress powdery mildew proliferation on the leaves of your plants. the first spot of powdery mildew, you can crack out this mixture and you can reapply it safely as often as you need to. It will not damage your plants. It will not damage the soil. But there's nothing in this mixture that I know of that is going to be harmful for your pollinators. So the first thing you need, well, actually, there's a couple of different ways you can concoct this mixture. You only really need two ingredients. I use four of them. So let's go through the basic recipe and then we'll go through my souped up recipe. So the first thing you need is you need whole milk. And the reason you want to use whole milk is that while the process is not perfectly understood as to why this so effectively kills powdery mildew, in fact, studies have shown that it is more effective than copper fungicides in suppressing and preventing and treating powdery mildew. You want to use whole milk because the fats and proteins in it are thought to be the main component that coats the leaf and creates a suppressive barrier that smothers the fungus and helps keep it from getting a foothold on the leaves of your plants. So whole milk, you can use goat's milk, cow's milk, whatever you got on hand. The other ingredient you need is just plain old water. And you want to use a ratio of about 40% milk to about 60% water. Pour them into your bottle, shake it up, and spritz your plant. That's it. So here's my souped up version. Okay. I use milk, whole milk. I use sometimes water, sometimes not. But there's two other ingredients I always use. And the first one is I use a compost tea of some kind in place of the bulk of my water. So because it is early in the season, what I'm using now is the vermiliquor from my worm bin, which is diluted one part vermiliquor to nine parts water. And if you don't have a lot of liquid accumulated from your worm bins, you can use the worm castings themselves. You can use about 3 tablespoons of worm castings for 1 cup of water and just let it soak and then strain it. Now later in the season, I will use compost tea or I will use nettle tea, fermented nettle tea, or I will use fermented comfrey tea. So why do I use these things instead of water? All of these are excellent foliar sprays for any of my plants, any time of year. I already am going to be applying foliar sprays. A lot of fruit trees do a great job of absorbing things through their leaves. It increases the health and vitality of your trees. And it helps compensate for the fact that perhaps you live in a system where your soil is rather depleted and you have not yet built up your soil to an extent where you don't have to add these kinds of extra supports. So I'll be showing you later in the year how I make my nettle and my comfrey fermented teas because they are both rich, really rich in nitrogen and potassium. Worm castings make a great option for any time of year because my worm bin is going all year long. So as long as I am going to be spraying with milk, why not go ahead and save myself an entire application and an entire effort of having to spray a tea on it later? Why not just combine them and do it at the same time? Now the last thing that I add, depending on the time of year, is that I use humic acid, which is available at Concentrates Northwest. And you only need a tiny, tiny bit. It makes a great foliar spray that helps support the health of your plants. And I'll put some links below for a little bit more about humic acid. Totally, you could take it or leave it, and a little bit goes a long way. But I add a little bit of that as well. So I've got my ingredients. I'm gonna add my 40% milk. And then if I have enough to make 60% of the tea, I will do that. If not, I'll just add water to get to where I'm at 60%. So I'm adding my milk, 2/3 of a cup of milk. Now, I have 1 cup here of my vermiliquor, which you want to be careful sometimes if you're using a worm casting tea that you make or you're just using the straight vermiliquor that's diluted, make sure there aren't any chunks in it that'll clog your spray nozzle. So I want to be really careful here. Now you can keep this in the fridge for up to a week or you can just apply it all at once. Some criticisms I have seen are that people think it's going to make your plants stink because, well, you're spraying milk on them, and what happens with milk when it's sprayed or left sitting outside? It goes rancid fairly quickly. I have not found that to be an issue. I've not found there's been any odor at all. And I'll explain to you how I apply it, and that will help, I think, eliminate some of that concern. So you can see here, I have a little bit that I didn't bother to strain out. I'll just put that under my aronia berry. I'm gonna add my little dash of humic acid. Okay, bam, I'm ready to go. I've got my spray. So now let's talk about how do you apply it. This is the worst kind of weather in which to apply your milk sprays to combat powdery mildew. This kind of weather promotes the growth of powdery mildew. We're gonna have a few days of cool rain and the ground will become quite saturated, and then it's supposed to warm back up. And then that combination of wet and then increased temperature and increased warmth and humidity, bam, powdery mildew is gonna be everywhere. So if you wanna make this up now and stick it in your fridge, you'll be ready to treat your plants. You wanna take a sunny day, and afternoon sun is the best. And the reason is that you're gonna spray and coat the leaves of your plants. And then you want that sunshine to beat down onto the leaves of your plants and very rapidly desiccate the milk spray. And in the process of doing that, what you find is that it will dry out very quickly and form that coating that smothers the fungal spores and smothers the existing powdery mildew and protects the leaf. So you don't want to do it on a cloudy, rainy day. It's just going to get washed off. You don't want to do it on a cloudy, overcast day. You really want something that you want the weather to be where the sun is going to bake it on there real quick. So save it for a super sunny day, but that is my recipe for powdery mildew treatment to support your plants. If you, like me, have a permaculture system that still needs caretaking by the gardener, that still needs some extra support because our systems have not reached the optimal state in which they are pretty balanced and taking care of themselves. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up. Please consider subscribing. It helps me get my videos out to more people. The more thumbs up and the more subscribers I have, the more the YouTube algorithm favors me and the more I can make videos for everybody. So thanks.